Deeper Insights into the Illuminati Formula by Fritz Springmeier and Cisco Wheeler. Podcast 17. Chapter 8, The Science of Body Manipulation and Programming. Continues. Bone and Skull Structure. Bones are alive and changing. It might be helpful to review what bones are made of, and how they change and grow, just in case the reader had some misconceptions such as that bones are fixed solids that don't change. Bones within the human body, especially the skull, give support and protection. Bone is comprised of an organic matrix synthesized and deposited by osteoblastic activity, calcium phosphate precipitates, and a mineralized phase of hydroxyapatite, which is primarily composed of calcium and inorganic phosphate, Roby, 1989. The primary ingredient of the organic matrix is a collagen in the form of fibers that are extensively cross-linked. Applies to 90% of the matrix. There are several types of collagen, type 1 predominant. This are as numerous non-collagenous proteins have also been discovered in bone, including some which have been identified as growth factors. Bone development and turnover is regulated by various bone cells, see Teitelbaum, 1990. The exact method the body uses to recreate new bone is too complex to describe here, but let it suffice that researchers are studying all the minute complexities of the abilities of the body to produce bone. Old bone is constantly being absorbed and reproduced new. BMUs are important to development of new bone. See studies like Frost, 1965, and Parfi, 1987. According to the Wall Street Journal, February 23, 1996, p. Al., in both Eastern and Western editions, some physicians are remolding lopsided skulls of infants with unnecessary surgery when the only problem is the child's sleep position, and the lopsided skull can be corrected with a headband rather than surgery. In terms of head shapes, which can be created by skilled manipulation of the skull bones, a vertical strain superior is associated with passiveness and dissociation. This is why some of the cults are either manipulating people's heads or recruiting people that have long faces in their cults. The vertical strain inferior is said to be connected to criminals. The programmers for the NWO have been intentionally manipulating people's skull to get passiveness and dissociativeness. Daniel Whiteside and John Wesley Grossman did extremely valuable work in statistically validating the clear connections between 60 behavior traits and physical structures. The physical shape of the brain is related to how the brain cells are proportioned. This science is called structure/function. Daniel's father, Robert L. Whiteside, was one of the founders of 3-in-1. Robert wrote an amazing book, Face Language. The Air Force Academy used it in three of their courses. Prior to encountering Robert's book, this author has noticed that the Japanese and Chinese have done a great deal of research and writing in this area. Our own language has come to reflect some of our intuitive ideas about structure/function, such as, he is level-headed. She is nosy. He's a real highbrow. And he leads with his chin. Cf. Face Language, p. 1112. Whiteside takes 40 pages to identify traits that are shown by the eyes. Then he explains traits that are shown by the mouth area. Then he deals with overall facial traits and finally profile traits. For instance, a large difference between one side of the face and the other indicates how much the individual changes with their mood change. If the head steadily gets wider as it runs from the mouth to the ears, then the person has the trait of acquisitiveness. A person who loves to be precise with words will develop little lines that fan out from the inner corner of the eye toward the cheekbone. The 3-in-1 college doesn't teach that the face reveals all behavior, but they teach their students what to expect from people, so that they can communicate better. Another 3-in-1 publication, Advanced One Brain by Gordon Stokes and Daniel Whiteside, reveals eye modes. NLP has also been teaching some of these eye modes to detect what a person is thinking. Another publication provides charts, designed by William Marabou, which explain different traits and how they exhibit themselves physically. For instance, if the eyes are extremely wide apart, the person will either see an open viewpoint as valuable or feel inadequate. The chart then charts out how the trait, of emotional tolerance, will exhibit itself under different circumstances. For instance, in doing a job they tend to lose track of time. Perhaps the value of all this is not clear in the reader's mind. In terms of mind control, if you know what physical structures will give you a particular trait, you can enhance what you want by skillful manipulation of the skull bones. The key to manipulating the skull lies in the fact that the skull bones actually float on the cerebrospinal fluid, while the brain floats in the fluid. In the booklet The Cranial Bowl by William G. Sutherland, 1984, he writes about what he calls the molding technique. The molding technique is the reshaping of the skull. He writes on page 28, the molding technique is especially adaptable to children, and even to the adult well along in the later period of life. In the booklet, he goes into details about the cerebrospinal fluid. Cerebrospinal fluid. The cerebrum, brain, and the spine float in a fluid that surrounds them. This fluid is called cerebrospinal fluid and is referred to on page 1050 of the massive anatomical reference book Gray's Anatomy 36th British ed. Edited by Williams and Warwick, printed by W.B. Saunder Co., 4 Churchill Livingstone. In 1920 and 1938, Weed published research on the circulation of the cerebrospinal fluid. As just one example of many of the roles that the CS fluid plays within the brain, that has been discovered is that the carotid artery has a branch that passes upward through a waterbed of cerebrospinal fluid. The CS fluid follows that internal carotid artery to the choroid plexus, so that it can perform the function of interchange with the arterial blood. The CS fluid is in command of this exchange. I mention this because see how this ties in with the fifth brain. In fact, a fourth ventricle compression is the most valuable and powerful CSF technique for helping people. It is mentioned simply to show people the effect that CSF has on some very important brain areas. Because the brain and spinal cord float in a fluid, a brain weighing 1,500 grams in the air, only weighs 50 gr in cerebrospinal fluid, which distributes the brain weight more evenly. The fluid itself is clear, slightly alkaline with a specific gravity of 1,007. About L00 mls of CS fluid will exist to float the brain and spinal cord. The spine rests in this cerebrospinal fluid, which has waves that approximate the breathing rhythm of the body. 50% of the cerebrospinal fluid is manufactured in one part of the head, choroid plexus uses, and spends its time fluctuating. It is absorbed and replenished, as other body elements are. The plexus uses, which are located in the lateral recesses of the fourth ventricle, also put cerebrospinal fluid into the subarachnoid space, and this supplies the cerebellomedullary cistern and the pontine cistern with fluid. The cerebrospinal fluid makes up a single fluctuating system of fluid within which the central nervous system / brain operate. As the brain coils and uncoils, waves of motion, energy, fluctuate in a spiral pattern through the cerebrospinal fluid in the skull, down the spinal column and up again, so that there is motion from front to back in the head and also laterally. As the human brain develops, the CSF seems to appear at the earliest stages. The brain goes through stages of development as the brain-spinal cord divide. The forebrain develops into several items, the midbrain into two parts, and the hindbrain into the first three brains. The cerebrospinal fluid is manufactured by the body, fluctuates in a single head spinal cord system, and then is absorbed and replenished by the body. The fluid does not circulate like blood. The fluid and the skull bones continue to fluctuate even if a person holds his breath. As long as the CSF oscillates like it should, things are fine, but if something occurs to pervert the rhythms, the health of the person goes down. Loss of sleep can influence the rhythms adversely. If the occipital motion is restricted, schizophrenia can result. When severe sphenobasilar symphysis locking occurs, there is frequently manic depression. Most people are totally unaware that these mental problems may be resulting from a CSF problem. Very little information is let out about the cerebrospinal fluid. Very little is released to the public about how over a period of time cranial osteopaths can develop the manipulative skill to control and change the fluctuations of these fluids. Only a few top people are allowed in on the secrets, and those people are handpicked members of the occult world. Some of the top cranial doctors are under monarch-type mind control themselves. The osteopathic libraries are staffed with people loyal to keeping cranial osteopathic secrets within the occult world. Could other doctors teach themselves? The ability to manipulate the cerebral spinal fluid is an art that has taken years to develop, and for practitioners to learn. As stated, the tests that doctors rely on, such as X-rays and MRIs, are too big and clumsy to be of any value in this area. The doctors would have to reinvent the wheel and then the automobile if they wanted to self-teach themselves. It often takes 2 to 3 years of study in this area, before a doctor is able to feel the movement of the fluid. The cranial bones have sutures between them, that allow a skilled person to move them. The sutures have been proven to move as much as 1/20th of an inch. The trained finger can perceive the natural motion of these sutures even if the natural motions are only 1/40th of an inch. In McCaddy's excellent book Essentials of Craniosacral Osteopathy, Bath, ENG, Ashgrove Press, p. 3, he states, contrary to some schools of thought, all circumstances being normal, the cranial sutures, or joints of the head, do not fuse regardless of age, race, sex, or geographic location. They are perpetually motile, influencing the dynamics of fluid exchange and membranous tension within the cranio-sacral mechanism. When early cranial osteopaths like Sutherland looked at the skull and its membranes and cartilage, they realized that the 18 human bones that make up the head were actually designed to articulate, move slightly. In fact, researchers have discovered the cranium has 3 distinct oscillations. Magown, Harold Ives, D.O. Osteopathy in the Cranial Field, p. 322. Maud Nerman, D.O. presented the outline of an interesting lecture and lab class that she gave in 1992, entitled Visualizing the Brain Under Our Hands, in which she taught the techniques for feeling the bones of the brain move with CS fluid fluctuations, as well as sensing what it was doing internally. Coordinating the movement of the skull bones with the movement of the CS fluid was called directing the tide by W.G. Sutherland. His Journal of the Osteopathic Cranial Association reported successes doing this. Ronald McCaddy teaches that some heads are less pliant than other. The practitioner will rest his trained hands on the head, wait, and allow the cranial motion to teach the cranial osteopath what is happening or needs to happen. The client will usually be laying down, and the doctor will be relaxed and focused. The motion of the CS fluid is called the cranial rhythmic impulse, CR1. It will pulse about 10 to 14 times/mm in normal adults and 12 to 16 times/mm in children. When a person is frightened, the CR1 can stop for up to 20 seconds. The mind is literally frozen. Tranquilizers will slow the CR1 rate down, as well as poor health. For someone who has been traumatized, such as with electroshock, the very mention of the traumatic event will cause the CR1 to temporarily stop. The cranial osteopath does not really force any bones, but rather gently encourages a skull bone in the direction it should go. Lightness of touch is a necessity. An example of the health benefits of the trained osteopath is given by McCaddy, that kink in the straight sinus can be, and often is, one of the primary causes of epilepsy and internal hydrocephalus. By treating the kink, the osteopath takes care of the problem, where the standard method is often to give the subject strong drugs. To give an example of how the CS fluid, CSF, can relate to our state of mind, consider the following by McCaddy, and again, change of direction of CSF from anterior-posterior to lateral is of paramount importance in the sleep-wake phenomenon. When you are standing, there is parallel action of CSF flow. When you lie down with your head on a pillow, this alters, you impinge on one or other temporal bone, you decelerate CSF activity. You, as it were, slow down the pendulum. You inhibit parallel action. By inhibiting this pendulum, you automatically produce an anteroposterior swing, which is parasympathetic, that is to say, the parts of the automatic nervous system that slow down the action of the heart when the body is not under stress, in order to conserve bodily energy. This author thought it was exciting to understand better how the mind/body relaxes and slows down when we lay our heads down. Transcendental Meditation, TM, and the Hindu Connection. Years ago, back in 1974, this author was a West Point cadet who was watching the U.S. Army introduce TM into the academy. It was presented as a scientific technique, and many officers, some friends, and other cadets availed themselves of the chance to train themselves in TM's mystical method of training. A fellow cadet who was already trained in martial arts quickly learned the techniques. After initially maintaining a safe distance, this author decided to investigate TM after I got out of the military. The U.S. government gave substantial grants to get TM introduced into this country. Fortunately, Christians didn't sleep long, and exposed that TM is Hinduism. Everyone that is taught TM is initiated into it by the TM instructor singing a puja, worship, song in Sanskrit, which is a Hindu devotional song, while incense and candles burn. Until the Christians exposed this, our national government went blithely along in promoting Hinduism into our public schools. For instance, the Department of Health, Education, and Welfare gave a $21,540 grant for 150 high school teachers to learn TM. TM has grown to be a powerful organization, with many organizations set up attached to it. It has its international headquarters at Hotel Sonnenberg in the Swiss village of Seelisberg. When I investigated TM back in 1975, this TM instructor, who was friends of mine, talked about her experience at Seelisberg. From the conversation with her, it was obvious that people had to surrender their will to the organization to go to Seelisberg, and some mind-altering experiences had taken place there. She participated in the Sdbiblestudy program to be able to dematerialize, walk through walls and levitate. But the program clearly had emotionally disturbed her and others who had been in it. Once a person is involved in the higher levels of TM, you don't just walk away from this cult. From my personal observations, I discovered that TM is involved in some types of mind manipulation, and that the organization is not above using deceit on unsuspecting people. What then becomes doubly interesting is that after observing these things, I learned that TM have a large interest in the cranial osteopathic techniques, which can alter the mind and personality of a person. For instance, this author has obtained a list of TM instructors in Santa Monica, CA area, who are also doctors of cranial osteopathy. But bear in mind, this whole thing is bigger than labels. When people are interested in the occult, they study eclectically. These TM cranial osteopaths are concentrated where TM has a secret Mum Mountain CA training site. There are cranial doctors in the nearby towns of Aptos, Capitola, Cupertino, Hollister, Los Gatos, Salinas, Santa Cruz, Saratoga, and Watsonville. It boggles the mind that 12 cranial doctors are needed for the rural area near Mum Mountain, while LA only has 10. Concentrations of cranial doctors occur in close proximity to TM centers, particularly around the Maharishi University in Fairfield, 10, as well as the secret Mum Mountain Training Center. Other cranial dos who are part of TM are scattered about the United States. Another observation which I made was that some of the people that got really big into TM are still searching for something to fill the voids and needs of their life. TM didn't turn out to be as big of an answer as they expected. TM is not the final answer. However, the Maharishi who brought TM to America has a college in Fairfield, Iowa, the Maharishi International University, and 20 North American heavenly communities operating in the quest to create a heaven on earth. The Maharishi International University has been used for medical experimentation on people. The close connections between the leadership of TM and the Illuminati leadership suggests that TM is being used as another haven for the NWO's mind control to be perpetrated on unsuspecting victims. There are bone setters in India also. Perhaps the Maharishi got his original interest in the potential for mind control via skull manipulation in India. Wherever the interest came from, it is evident that TM in America is involved in skull manipulation for its mind control results. The three-in-one school connection. If one wants to surrender oneself to a cult, and allow one's mind to be controlled, In order to learn, the three-in-one school will be happy to teach you about what others would call phrenology and manipulation of the skull to control thinking. The school has a number of courses. They do not call their principles phrenology. Nor do they call their instruction mind control. They identify to the student areas of the head and what type of thinking that area of the head is involved with. They also provide information so that their students can evaluate how people will act based on the shape of their heads and how that shape will interact with other shapes. The school is located at 2001 West Magnolia Boulevard, Burbank, California, 91506 PH No 818-841-4786. They teach Ericksonian hypnosis, good for programmers to know, bodywork, including cranial osteopathy, which is good for programmers to know, and they teach NLP, mind-controlled relationships, along with scripts, mind-controlled adolescent problems, and a pantheistic religious philosophy and religion. When the three-in-one school got started, they were teaching muscle testing and other important skills to their students, who can become facilitators in teaching others. The muscle manipulation they have taught is extremely gentle and way beyond what the chiropractors knew. The school in California began about 10 years ago, and then a few years later they began to tighten their hold on all their graduates and their students. The school has been drawing students from Europe, Japan, China, Russia, and South America, including Brazil. They have moved more and more toward being an occult cult or perhaps an Illuminati front. When given information that their muscle techniques could be used to help multiples, they have made it clear, according to one school administrator, that they are not interested in helping multiple personalities. One school administrator named Gordon Stokes said, "We're off in another direction." In fact, Gordon Stokes is the founder of 3-in-1. Technically, a co-founder, Daniel Whiteside and Candace Calloway helped. Some speculate that the 3-in-1 name refers to this triumvirate, and perhaps to their relationship together. Gordon Stokes has been reported to be a member of the BODA, which is an international mystery school of the hierarchy. BODA stands for Builders of the Adytum. It is a Kabbalistic Hermetic order of adepts founded in the 1920s by Dr. Paul Foster Case, reportedly on direction by the hierarchy. The BODA teaches higher states of consciousness to its adepts. It is located at 5105 No. Figueroa St., Los Angeles, California, 90042. Daniel Whiteside's parents are deeply involved in personology. And Candace Calloway's mother, their bookkeeper, has also been a major figure at the 3-in-1 school. This 3-in-1 school in Burbank seems to be a finishing school for Illuminati programmers. The school ridicules people who want to examine their life or have a conscience. Christianity is considered to be an obnoxious, tyrannical religion by the school. The information that they teach would be very helpful for mind control programmers, and their occult philosophy would scare off moral people from participating. The 3-in-1 research has been geared into how the brain works. Their research shows that if a person has more brain cells in a particular region of the brain, they are more developed in that intellectual area. For instance, if the action based on feeling area, the parietal lobe, has lots of cells, the person will be more active than thoughtful. If the person has more cells in the brain's conscious associational thinking area, frontal lobes, they will think more than act. They call their system based upon this research comparative cell proportion. There were many ancient works that noticed personality traits in relationship to head shapes. 3-in-1 article: The background of structure slash function states, you can read about the basis of structure slash function in the Hebrew Kabbalah's Book of Zohar, which is literally Aristotle's Physiognomonica, as well as in the writings of Maimonides and those of almost every famous Arabian philosopher during medieval times. Stokes, Daniel. The background of structure slash function, 1991, p. 2. The Cranial Academies. The Cranial Letter also picked up on the connection between the Kabbalah and cranial manipulation. A class on the Kabbalah and osteopathy is advertised in the May 95 issue, p. 9. Until Freud captured the interest of students of the mind, phrenology was psychology. Phrenology studied what could be measured, Freud got people looking for the hidden. In 1938, Dr. Edward Vincent Jones improved upon phrenology and classic physiognomy and developed personology. His system was an instant hit and he was given the go-ahead and conduct research on inmates at San Quentin Prison, and what is now LA's giant USC County Hospital. Interestingly, it was not long after Jones' research there, that Cisco Wheeler's father, trained as a programmer, was assigned by the Illuminati to organize covens in the San Quentin prison. The Whitesides became disciples of Jones' research and went on to statistically validate his system. One of their best students then was Gordon Stokes of Sacramento, who then moved to San Francisco to be better trained by the Whitesides. As mentioned, 60 traits have been validated statistically. By looking at the skull and head, the skin, the body tone, the eyes, and other areas, the practitioners of structure/function can accurately tell a person's personality. Because this type of information has been in the possession of Kabbalists, it is not surprising that the average person is ignorant of all this. However, the potential for good or evil with this knowledge is tremendous. They also used applied kinesiology to diffuse emotional stress. For this work, they divide the brain into the dominant side, the left, and the alternate side, the right. Then each of these hemispheres is again divided between the fore and back brains for diffusion. Applied kinesiology is used to gain information about a trauma, and the diffusion is used to release any negative emotional stress around an incident. This also possibly could be used to dilute the emotional impact of some assignment done by a slave. In the first 3-in-1 newsletter of 1995, page 1, they write, "Self-image is the key to good learning performance. What magic do we use to help slow learners and people labeled as learning disabled change for the better so dramatically?" This is just one minor example of how these groups like to reframe what they do in occult terms. The mind control programmers need only have someone skilled in the manipulation of the cranial bones and the skull bones, and they can with repeated delicate precision reshape a person's skull and also his brain's shape, thus manipulating the personality and looks. Photos of Marilyn Monroe, Irma Jean, during her life strongly suggest that type of cranial manipulation was done to her for mind control purposes. The occult world has maintained a dogged resolve to keep the deeper cranial knowledge and skill secret. Dr. Sutherland's wife wrote his story with thinking fingers. She states on page 62, "It was Dr. Sutherland's cherished dream that a day would come when the benefits to the mentally ill through the cranial component in osteopathy would be investigated. If that was his dream, it is being hijacked today by those who see it as a tool for power over their fellow men." B. Genetic engineering. A great deal of secret experimentation has gone on in underground installations with genetics. This author has had the privilege of debriefing someone who worked at the Area 51 underground installation. He was murdered after having had several long interviews with this author. Truth is stranger than fiction. It goes without saying that the Illuminati has gathered up every harebrained idea for controlling and manipulating the human race. That doesn't mean every one of them has been attempted, but they have the means to carry out very bizarre experiments in their underground facilities, such as the ones at Area 51. There is no question that they have tried to augment natural human features and replace natural human parts. Who knows what weird transgenetic or cybernetic beings have been created? This author knows that they have been successful in some of their work at reshaping humans. This author has accumulated a great deal of information on the underground installations from eyewitnesses, but there is no way of knowing what is accurate and what is disinformation. However, a few details are definite. These underground installations are massive and they involve genetic manipulation to create new species or breed special types of people. In the Volume 2 book, we discussed the Aquaman subspecies that the NWO has created with gills and special skin. These people look like normal people unless observed closely. They had extra genetic material inserted in the genetic material that created them. They are called transgenic humans because they still closely resemble other people. In order for transgenic humans to pass their new added features to the next generation, they need to mate with other similar transgenic humans. However, the NWO has been secretly creating chimeras. Chimeras is the widely used name for beast men. This research is generally not for the public to see but is done in some of the underground facilities listed in Appendix 2. An example would be a creature that was half human and half some other beast. On a BBC TV show on October and November 1988, the British showed the result of a gorilla being artificially inseminated with a human sperm. The experiment was done by British researchers working for the government and the result ended in a child looking remarkably like a normal person. However, the common people who viewed it were outraged. Most people are not really excited about scientists playing God and destroying the human race by genetic tampering. Of course, the scientists who do these genetic games have lots of excuses and rationales, many of which have been put into print, to justify their research. People are being bred for specific purposes by the Illuminati, just like this author bred dairy cows. Parents with certain desired features are obtained. In fact, the Nazis' secret superdog Löwenherz Doggo Argentino, which looks like a race of weightlifting dogs, and the secret 100-year-old Paraguayan Nueva Germania colony of special bred Aryans are still in existence. The New York Times had an article on September 17, 1992, where a Washington psychiatrist Dr. Peter Bregan accused the federal government of a genetic violence initiative in which the government was involved with genetic research as it relates to crime and violence. Dr. Susan Solomon is one of the government's leaders involved in researching violence. However, from what this author can gather, the government's research is far more reaching than the New York Times article even begins to imply. By genetic breeding and manipulation, the Illuminati are trying to strengthen certain mental features. Considering that this has already been done for centuries by mankind to other species, for instance, when mankind domesticated the horse, the dog, the cat, the llama, the chicken, then it is no secret that a docile servile slave class of humans can be created. The primary goal of this Illuminati breeding is to create a class of people who can work together with others, herd instinct, and who will take orders willingly. Independent thinking and intelligence are not wanted. Educational goals and a worldwide educational system that can accommodate these types of workers is being created worldwide to deal with the eventual working class drones that the Illuminati want to create. The creation of this educational system at this present time has four goals: 1. To develop a group mindset, 2. To have education carried out by the multinational corporations, 3. To have students educated on the premise that truth is relative, 4. To teach compliance. Already the public schools in America are gearing up for the government to dictate what occupations young students can study for. In other words, our educational system is being set up for mind control, and this is to eventually work hand in hand with worker slaves that have the genetics needed to be good compliant stupid slaves. There have also been studies of intelligence such as the five-volume genetic studies of genius started by L.M. Terman in 1925, pubbed by University of Stanford Press. The world order has specific and successful methods to create a class of technical people. At this point, people whose thinking abilities have been created by the monitoring/manipulating of their genetics is a small but increasing number. Genetic control of breeding is unfortunately where the programmers are headed. This is not happening for the genetic betterment of the human species, this is for the perverted lusts of these demon-possessed megalomaniacs who think they deserve to rule with a sadistic iron fist. Those who mistakenly think the mind control programmers are trying to improve the human race, need to get to know the programmers better. See Appendix A for biographical information on some of the programmers. Those poor gullible naive people who think that when the global masters visibly introduce the new world order that the NWO will be tolerable if they can simply keep their noses clean, not fight back, and do their jobs, are sadly mistaken. They do not know the dark, sinister side to these global masters. As one man very close to the center of power said to a common man about the men who rule the world, if you stepped on an ant, you would have more conscience than the global elite have in manufacturing wars and killing millions of people. They want power and they intend to amass total power no matter what the cost. Another area of Illuminati deception and control. Ionizing radiation used in conjunction with chemicals to manipulate the genetics of the mind, or say this another way, using radiation and chemicals to change genetics associated with thinking. When a retired high-ranking military man first told this author that radiation research had to do with mind control, my reaction was probably like most people's, puzzlement. I thought that radiation was quite lethal and that genetic research with radiation was to protect us from some kind of atomic attack. Wrong. That is a nice cover story. Since that retired colonel, who may not have long to live, talked to me, others have said similar things. Like many things that the world order does, if we don't have a frame of reference of what is going on, we can live around what they are doing day in and day out and never see all the clues as to what is going on under our noses. One trauma-based mind-controlled slave, Chris DeNicola, spied on the files of the doctor who did radiation experiments on her. She saw the following radiation file headings, and their codes: canker sore, D7040, laser documentation, D7000, nautical science, D1015, pediatric radionthology, L6542. One idea is that this file might pertain to child altars, penetrating wave activity, radiation experimentation, L6540, radioactive distortions, radioactive material contamination, radioactive verification, radioactive waves, radionthology, electrolyte prodigies experiments, 654-011, laser light distortions experiments, 654-012, and laser light technology experiments, 101-015. One reason that this author is providing the code numbers of these files is that memories of slaves who are involved in these experiments or projects often are internally coded with these file codes. The date the experiment was done will also be added as part of the code. When this author researched their genetic research, I was utterly amazed at how many institutions worldwide are carrying out deep research into genetics, much of which will contribute to the enslavement and mind control of the human race. Just a sampling of countless labs working hard on this mind control related genetic research include Brookhaven National Labs, Upton, New York, John Hopkins University, Baltimore MD, Institute for Genetique, the Free University of Berlin, Germany, Institute of Hygiene and Epidemiology, Czech, Radiation Genetic Lab and Chemical Mutagenesis, State University of Leiden, Sylvius Labs, Leiden, the Netherlands, MIT, Cambridge, MA, Gesellschaft für Strahlen und Umweltforschung, Munich, Germany, National INST of Environmental Health Sciences Research Triangle Park, North Carolina, Sandoz Labs in Basley, Switzerland, Biology Division, Oak Ridge National Lab, Oak Ridge, Tennessee, Roswell Underground Labs, NM, Stanford Research Institute, Menlo Park CA, Shell Labs, Kent, England, University of Michigan, Ann Arbor MI, the Zentralabor für Mutagenitätsprüfung der Deutschen Forschungsgemeinschaft, Freiburg, Germany. This is just a tiny sampling of the enormous worldwide research devoted to genetics that pertain to mind control. While there are numerous surnames among the genetic researchers, because this author knows as a fact that some of these researchers are Illuminati, it doesn't quiet one's curiosity to see the better known Illuminati surnames such as DuPont, Hersey, Fox, Frey, Jung, Lee, Patterson, Stewart, Sinclair, Sutherland, and Russell appearing among the genetic researchers doing research that pertains to mind control. Obviously, this author can't give all the ways they have figured out to use radiation, along with chemicals and genetics, to control the human race. I will try to give you a peek in the window. The real deep and dangerous information is of course highly classified material and protected by their mind control of those scientists who work for them. When I say mind control, that includes such methods as blackmail and threats of assassination. There is a type of radiation called ionizing radiation that means it is radiation that gives off electrons, thus producing ions. There are many different types of ionizing radiation. Some go right through the body, some damage the cells, but the body repairs itself, some causes genetic changes, and some simply hits your cells like a sledgehammer and kills them. The ionizing radiation that changes genetics has been the focus of an incredibly enormous amount of, mostly secret, research. Genes are instructions that tell non-life material how to organize itself into something living. A gene consists of genetic material called DNA and RNA. Genes also provide instructions for how something is to develop. As a person or animal develops, the genes interact with the environment to create what the person or animal is like. For instance, different breeds of dogs when born are more similar than after they grow up. Different breeds of dogs have been bred for different genetic traits, and as different breeds grow up, their genes continually interact with the environment to create the adult dog. So full genetic expression can take a lifetime. The link between genetics and behavior can be seen in this quote from the Quarterly Review of Biology, art by T.C. Schneerla, 1966, p. 283, behavioral ontogenesis is the backbone of comparative psychology. Shortcomings in its study inevitably handicap other lines of investigation from behavioral evolution and psychogenetics to the study of individual and group behavior. Genetic psychology has revealed that the genes program in methods for an organism to adjust to their environment. So genetic instruction is, for instance, more than just the instruction be smart, be aggressive, be tall, but it is tailoring the way a person develops to deal with its environment. In other words, behaviors are programmed into a person via their genes, genetic instructions, to provide mechanisms for quick, dynamic adaptations to changing circumstances. These mechanisms, created by genetic codes, may even have the person, or animal, reverse their behavior for purposes of survival. Within the human brain, also all mammal brains, all the neurons are believed to be generated before birth with the exception of the following cells: granule cells of the olfactory bulb, fascia dentala granule cells in the hippocampus, the granule cells of the cerebellar cortex, and the granule cells of rhombic lip in the brainstem. It's the brainstem cells that the Illuminati manipulate through brainstem scarring to produce photographic memories for their scientists and computer programmers. The germinal cells create neurons in the germinal zone. Brain cells with a common function develop from a common lineage, although from different sites. After a new neuron develops in the germinal zone, they migrate to whatever location they are to live in. The complicated process of how a neuron discovers where to go, migrate to in the brain, has not been discovered according to what this author has read. When neurons establish themselves, they deal with certain neurotransmitters that establish communication between them and other neurons. Researchers have discovered that neurons can change their own makeup to take different neurotransmitters if they decide their environment in the brain needs it. They also grow their dendrite connections depending on what type of connections are needed for that particular brain to function. For instance, a piano player will develop dendrite connections to be able to play well. These discoveries show once again that even on the cellular level, genetic instructions are complex and designed to give flexibility and adaptability of the cell to the situation for the cell. Genetic programming begins at the cellular level. There is a cellular consciousness besides the consciousness that we think about. DNA structures which are inherited affect the cellular consciousness. Body memories are contained within the physiological structure. The first brain and the body work off a stimulus-response recording mechanism. Body memory and programming are stored at this level. This is an area of the brain that is always on. However, its view or perception of events is not an exact copy of what other higher brains are thinking. Your conscious mind doesn't remember how the stairs and the room are arranged, but in the dark, your primal part of your mind helps guide your steps. Various drugs and chemicals have been identified that influence particular learning sequences in the mind, such as imprinting. For instance, hexamethonium chloride antagonizes the nicotinic actions of acetylcholine on the ganglia, or in other words, acetylcholine will depolarize the ganglia but is prevented by the hexamethonium. The overall result is that impulses that the sympathetic ganglia would transmit are blocked. This is just one example of countless examples of how a specific chemical can affect a specific brain action. There is a branch of genetic research called developmental social behavior genetics which deals with how genetics program in social behaviors of animals and people. For instance, these geneticists study how genes create aggression, courtship, territorial behaviors, behaviors involving mothers and fathers, dominance, pecking order, behaviors, sexual behaviors, attraction behaviors, recognition behaviors, etc. Men are very much controlled by the sexual lusts, power lusts, and aggressive behaviors. Can the reader see how genetic manipulation of these genetic-based behaviors could radically change the potential behavior of a person? A fox's genes cause him to react differently than a rabbit's genes. Having a rabbit grow up in a fox home is not going to change the genetic instructions. The Bible even says, "Can a leopard change its spots?" But the world order has figured out how to change those instructions. Genetic researchers had to begin sorting out behaviors, and sorting out genes that affected them. For instance, genes create a person's, or animal, reproductive instincts. These instructions include instructions on fighting, nest building, mating, and care of their offspring. These genetic instructions are different for different people and different animals. Researchers into imprinting have discovered that if a set of animals, or people, is prevented from learning a particular imprint, and if that set of animals breed, then they pass on a lack of ability to receive that imprint. In other words, genetically we learn from generation to generation. Let's say that we prevent men from naturally imprinting a sexual desire for women as they grow up. If we mate those men to women, the offspring will show a reduced ability to be heterosexual. Males seem to develop their sexuality, but females seem to react more on the basis of genetically present releasers. Genetic researchers have gone in and identified what people's behavioral instructions specifically are, and how to change them. The instructions are written in DNA, and manipulation of DNA can change those instructions. When I researched their genetic research, I found that they have developed maps for how to change genetic material to change those instructions concerning behavior. The maps for changing human genes related to behavior are classified, but an example of one that isn't is found in the book The Genetics of Behavior, ed. Ehrman and Parsons. Sinaur Association, Inc. PUBL, Sunderland, Mass., 1976, Chapter 8, Figure 4. This map shows three sites in a HK gene that are intentionally mutated by the scientists in order to change the way a particular fly sings its mating call. The specific changes in how the fly sings its new mating call, after the genetic code is changed by geneticists, are even graphed out in a recording graph in another book, Developmental Behavior Genetics, Neural, Biometrical, and Evolutionary Approaches, ed. By Han et al., Oxford, ENG, Oxford University Press, 1990, Fig 6-1. Again, bear in mind that we only get the crumbs of what they know. We get a map of how they can change the way a fly sings a song while they secretly keep the genetic maps to change human behavior. An easy example of how genetics play a role in human behavior can be seen in how infants behave toward their mothers and toward strangers. By using twins and adopted children, etc., it could be clearly demonstrated that the behavior of a child in how it touches its mother was genetically inherited. But remember that the genetic instructions as a child grow older are designed to give it flexibility in relationship to its environment, so the environment is going to interact with the genetics to form the final behaviors. The study of these reactions of genes to the environment is called the study of epigenesis. Another easy example of the genetic role in human behavior is that intelligence has been linked to brain to body size. Genes ultimately determine that ratio of brain to body size. The factors involved are largely prenatal maternal influences. A great deal has been learned in this area. Brain size relates less to body size than it is a function of body metabolism. See research by Land and Martin, to give a tiny sample of the types of genetic studies done in this area. Hahn, M.E., and Haber, S.B. Dominance for large brains in laboratory mice. Behavior Genetics, 1979, 9, pages 243-244. Fuller, J.L. and Giles, H. Brain Growth in Mice Selected for High and Low Brain Weight. Developmental Psychobiology, 1972, 5, pages 307-318. Riska, B., and Achley, W.R. Genetics of Growth Predict Patterns of Brain Size Evolution. Science, 1985, 229, pages 668-671. Research into how to control humans genetically proceeded in several directions. First, scientists realized that radiation was the key to changing genetics. Radiation causes breaks and changes in the DNA instructions. If only one little bit of genetic DNA instruction is changed in 1 million bits of information, that change could radically change the life of the person or animal. We see that every day, cleft lips. But how does radiation affect genetics? DNA has been studied from every angle. DNA has been looked at, probed, tested with all kinds of chemicals and countless other manipulations. The scientists figured exactly how the different DNA is constructed, what makes it tick, how it joins, holds together, reproduces, etc. They can disassemble and rebuild DNA however they want. DNA is the genetic instructions. Since radiation will affect DNA, they tested a long list of ionizing radiation substances on DNA. Different radiations will break the DNA in different ways. Chemicals will join to DNA in certain ways. Long story short, there are millions of ways to manipulate genetic material, and the world order set out to discover how to precisely manipulate certain kinds of genetic material in certain ways. An example of how skilled they are in understanding most everything about to construct and take apart the molecules of genetic material, at Cold Spring Harbor Labs, one of the 1997 courses offered students is molecular cloning of neural genes. They understand what makes a nerve cell and how to create one. This science is called molecular neurobiology. This course at Cold Springs HL happens to be taught by instructors from Rockefeller University, Harvard, Johns Hopkins, and UC of Berkeley. One area of intense study for many years was a long-term scramble to find chemicals that would cause different types of mutations in DNA. This research was called comparative chemical mutagenesis. In fact, one of the books this author studied was entitled just that, Comparative Chemical Mutagenesis, ed. By DeSeres and Shelby. This book's chapters 16-18, 22-25 are about chemical genetic research concerning how to create genetic changes in mammals using chemicals. When it comes to genetics, much of what is learned from studying one mammal will apply to humans. The chemical principles are the same, the DNA is written in the same code, only the genetic instructions written in that code is different. To make an analogy, this book is written in English. Once someone understands how English works, they can take apart a sentence and rewrite it. Top-level genetic scientists know how to take apart genetic instructions and rewrite them. Radiation used in conjunction with chemicals presents them a tool for the mass editing of human genetic instructions. No wonder the Chernobyl nuclear accident happened. Insiders in the know say that it was caused on purpose. What a great way to carry out more mind control research. According to public research, genetic mutations were created by scientists in mammal cells first in 1968. It is likely that this had already been accomplished in secrecy before this. Labs all over the world went about testing genetic material with specialized chemicals to see what would happen to various genetic material when it came in contact with specific chemicals. Some of the commonly tested mutagen chemicals that were widely tested to discover their mutagenicity. Mutagenicity is the word geneticists use to describe the power of a chemical to cause a mutation, include aflatoxin B1, aft, this is a mold metabolite and is not always effective without another agent. Cadmium chloride. Cadmium salts. Cyclophosphamide, CP. Dimethylnitrosamine, DMN. Epichlorohydrin. Ethylenamine. Ethyl methane sulfonate, EMS. Methyl methane sulfonate, MMS. Mitomycin C, a strong mutagenic at low doses. Mylaran, aka busulfan. N.methylene nitro, N, nitrosiguanidine, MNNG. Notolon, aka procarbazine, this chemical was strongly mutagenic in the lab with the presence of S9, but weak without the presence of S9. TEPA. Theotepa. Trenimin. Triethylenlamine. Vinyl chloride. When these chemicals, and others, were tested on genetic material, the mutations they caused in the genetic material were observed, and then the specific type of mutation each caused was charted. Some caused chromosome type changes, others caused chromatid type changes, and some caused sub or half chromatid changes. These sub changes usually were in the mitotic portion of the cell cycle. When the chemicals broke chromosomes, they were called clastogens. Others cause chromosomes to lose genetic material by damaging the mitotic apparatus. Many of the chemicals that were first tested only produced chemical changes in the chromatid type of change. They discovered that the protective mechanisms of animals, plants, and humans were protecting against many of their induced mutations, but they also learned what mutations they could create that the body would not fix or recover from. Along with finding out what certain chemicals would do, the world order wanted to find out what would happen at the molecular level of DNA when subjected to different types of radiation. The key to using radiative material is that there are many different types of radiative substances, not just uranium. For instance, cadmium is radioactive and can be used in genetic manipulation. In researching radiation, the first stage is when free radicals are created. This takes only a very small fraction of a second. The next is the chemical transformation of those radicals into stable radiation substances, and finally the last stage are the effects of these substances when the body incorporates them. The effects of the radiation substances on a person may last several years. The effects of radiation take place on the molecular level of DNA. When you and I went to school, we were taught that DNA occurs as a double helix around an invisible common axis. The core of the helix is a series of purine and pyrimidine bases stacked in a parallel array and are arranged almost perpendicular to the invisible axis of the helix. However, the reality is that DNA can also exist in three, triple, double-stranded helix structures which are called the ADNA, the BDNA, and the cDNA. At high humidities, the ADNA will transform into ABDNA if excess salt is in the area. In ADNA, the normal of the base pairs is tilted by 200 to the helix axis. In contrast, in the BDNA the base pairs are perpendicular. In some viruses and bacteria, single-stranded DNA is found. DNA also comes in supercoiled in some situations. The point is simply that DNA occurs in ways other than we learned in school. They discovered that the energy of the sugar phosphate backbone of the DNA allows for the DNA bases to be stacked, and is the key to the stability of the DNA. The vertical stacking of the bases gives stability of the DNA helix. They discovered that the helical structure of DNA is strongly influenced by its base composition and molecular weight. I mention these only to point out that they know all about what DNA is and how it is built and holds itself together. The genetic radiation researchers had to learn how the bases of the DNA held together electronically. They needed to learn how well these molecules of these different bases would accept electrons or donate electrons, because ionized radiation is substances that give off electrons or other ionizing particles. Directly ionizing particles are atomic particles that are charged, such as electrons, protons, alpha, A, particles, heavy ions, etc. An example of something the researchers found is that the cytosine base was the best acceptor of all the DNA bases. They began the process of testing different radioactive substances on DNA to see how they would cause mutations. To study this type of research, this author read several books such as Effects of Ionizing Radiation on DNA, Springer Verlag PUBL, Berlin, Germany, 1978. An example of a chapter in this book is radiation-induced degradation of the base component in DNA and related substances. This chapter shows charts of what happens to DNA components, such as thymine, cytosine, and uracil, when they are exposed to radiation. This author wants to cover some details of the type of discoveries these researchers made to make a point that specific chemicals and specific types of ionizing radiation will produce different effects upon DNA. Although these are very specific minute details, the reason they are mentioned here is that the bottom line is that some chemicals work with some types of radiation to produce specific mutations. They discovered that if a mutagenic such as aminoacridine dye is absorbed by cells, this dye which binds to the nucleic acids, absorbs light to such a degree that the cells are destroyed. Different variations of dyes bind to the DNA in different strong and weak binding processes. Lambda radiation was tested on DNA. They observed that positive and negative ions were randomly produced throughout the DNA and that these are chemically unstable and undergo free radical reactions to form stable radiation products. They discovered that there was a consistent oxygen effect which was made into a radiobiological law which described how the presence of oxygen enhances radiation damage in all forms of cell life. Another interesting discovery was that 5-bromouracil, Bulletin, enhanced the rate of radiation-induced free radicals forming within gamma-irradiated DNA. Researchers discovered that a naturally occurring substance in cells, the sulfhydryls, would bind with iodoacetic acid and n-ethylmalimide, which made them radiosensitive, and would result in certain mutations. Still one more example of a compound that works with radiation to cause changes in the DNA is triacetonium-n-oxyl, or TAN for short. This is a stable free radical that combines with DNA. TAN comes from a group of nitroxide free radicals which all have the same influence on DNA. Metronidazole, aka flagyl, was also found to be another of the nitroimidazoles and nitrofuranes that are oxygen mimics that worked in the lab as radiosensitizers of DNA. Chemical biological weapons are referred to as CB weapons. In a transcript attached to the Department of Defense Appropriations for 1970, Part 6, that I have of CB weapons researchers talking, they indicate that the United States has BZ which brings about complete mental disorientation as well as sedation which induces sleep. First of all, the individual is completely confused as to what he is doing or what he is supposed to do, and in addition he has hallucinations. He cannot carry out his assigned duties nor can he remember what his assigned duties were. The affect of BZ lasts for about 3 days and then the person will begin to recover. It can be given via the air or the water. If it is drank or inhaled, it will work. It takes effect about 1 to 1.5 hours after it is ingested. There are a number of corporations that can produce BZ in the US. At the time of the transcript, it was stated that BZ is $20 per pound and a lead time of 6 months for production. Chemical incapacitants have been developed that affect the mental functions of the mind in various ways. Today, research and deployment continues of chemical and radioactive substances that can control people. One of the methods that chemical and radioactive materials work is to change genetic structures. Some of the genetic changes that can be created chemically are chemical changes that affect the way the mind thinks. In a nutshell, we are looking at a situation where the thinking of an entire race could be altered via chemicals dropped into their air and water. How long would these genetic changes last? It is conceivable that some of the changes might have long-range consequences. Again, the bottom line is that the world order has at its disposal radioactive substances that can distribute it in conjunction with chemicals to mind control large geographic regions by genetic manipulation. These radioactive substances and chemicals can be distributed over vast areas by the air and water of a geographic region. It is conceivable that within a short time, the United States will experience chemicals administered via the air, or the drinking water used in conjunction with specific external stimuli to reinforce certain types of mind control programming on a mass of people. A chemical that makes people susceptible to suggestion could be used over a geographic area while hypnotic television messages and elf waves, etc. contribute to the mind control operation. Therapists are going to begin encountering victims of mind control born in the 1960s or later that have been subjected to chemical radiation changes to the genetics that control human behavior. There are already dozens of very vocal victims of both radiation experiments and mind control that are speaking up. Unfortunately, the ones that this author knows do not have a long life expectancy, and speaking up usually has the effect of shortening a whistleblower's life. In this Deeper Insights book, the movie Jacob's Ladder was mentioned. This movie shows a unit in Vietnam which was given a drug to make them aggressive, but the drug backfired because they killed each other. However, the reason the movie was allowed to be produced is that it was a good cover for the fact that the military did not give up, but that they actually succeeded in producing their magic chemical potion to turn soldiers into killing machines. The biology of aggression has been figured out. Military studies on the relationship between drugs and the ability to kill have been numerous. One example is Gabriel, R.A. Military Psychiatry, A Comparative Perspective. New York, Greenport Press, 1986. The world order has the ability to create the warrior spirit, actually it's worse than that, they have the ability to turn men into killing machines. What we've covered. As horrible as the physical manipulation of the brain and its fluids is, and as monstrous as the genetic manipulation of the growth of the brain as outlined in this chapter are, they are only a few methods of mind control of many that the Illuminati have at their disposal. These techniques seriously raise the question: how much longer will humanity as we know it survive? The next generation of children will have to face mind control in the form of genetic tampering and the use of chemicals already stockpiled by the NWO.